So today let's take a look at an interesting parking sensor called FenSens. It was made by a company probably also called FenSens, and it was donated to me, so thank you, and here's the link to the website of the company. I didn't open it yet, but as far as I know it's a wireless system which pairs with a free application for your smartphone. So you basically download an application into your phone and pair it with this sensor, and this sensor is actually built into a license plate frame. Your phone will then display probably the distance between your car and some obstacles when parking, so you don't crash. So it looks quite useful, especially if you are not a good driver. But I'm currently using a different type of parking sensor. I call it an audio zero distance detector. When I hear a crash, it's probably too close. But this one definitely looks more sophisticated. So let's take a look at it. And it actually took me quite a lot of time to make a video about it because I was traveling and there is so many things to do in summer. So it contains the sensor built into the license plate frame, some quick launch button, not sure what it is, some anti-theft tools, phone mount, universal AA batteries probably, user manual which nobody reads, and you can download the application for it. And you can mount it on the front of your car or on the back of it. If you want to have it on both sides, you have to buy two pieces of this. It's wireless, the batteries can last 9 months, and it can detect obstacles up to 3 meters. Here's how the application looks like, probably, and now let's try to open it. Designed in California, assembled in China, smartphone not included, of course, and here's some ass coverage. So let's open it. It's quite a big box. And I'm sorry for making this video with such a long delay, but there is so many things to do in summer, and I was also making another video and traveling and so on. So it opens like this. It slides. And there is another box. Let's open it. Quite a big box, it barely fits in my camera view. And here it is. This one looks like the sensors. There are two of them. And this is the license plate holder. You probably mount it on it like this. And here is the manual, which nobody reads. Quite long. And a lot of things for mounting, some wrenches, screws, and nails. Looks interesting. Some other holders, and probably batteries, a button cell, CR2032. Some AA batteries, lithium batteries, which is nice, very long life. Another few lithium batteries, nicer than yours. Interesting. Some magnet for mounting, maybe, and a button. Before use, please insert the battery. Now I have to figure out how to use it. Lithium batteries have a very long life and also a very long storage life, but this one looks expired. It says 1711. Or is it actually a manufacture date or expiration date? I hope it's manufacture. So let's try to test it. This one is just a plastic frame, so it's not needed for the test. There are some holders, not necessary, some mounting tools, screws, double-sided sticky tapes. And what remains is this actual sensor, this button, probably to activate it, and some batteries, and that's it. So the batteries probably go here. We have to unscrew it using those tools. Which one is the right one? This one? Yes. We can unscrew this cover from it, probably to reveal the battery space. It's quite tightened. Let's unscrew it and test it open. And there is space for 4 AA batteries. So let's try to insert those batteries, which are in a very nice package. It looks like airtight sealed package. Very nice batteries, lithium batteries, and the best ones. So let's insert it. It fits in the other two batteries. So is it using those four batteries in series, or are those two sensors completely independent? It looks like it may be two completely independent sensors, each one having its own batteries. But I have to completely disassemble it to make sure, of course. And here's the button to activate it. Before use, please insert the battery. Of course. Here is the holder for the actual wireless button. Using this button cell, 2032, 3-volt lithium battery, which goes probably here, like this. And let's close it. And this one is just a holder for it. And now it should be prepared. And now, of course, the hardest part, getting the application and learning how to use it. And those batteries, by the way, have quite a high voltage. 1.84, even though it says just 1.5 volts. And of course, somebody's going to help me. So, can you help me getting the application? I think I should try Google Play and looking for FenSens, and it's probably there. Let's click it, install it. I have to agree that I'm giving my house to them, probably. It's being installed. 26 megabytes, that's quite a lot. My cat is helping me, of course. Still installing. 77%, 82, and that's it. Or still installing, or is it stuck now? Okay, it seems to be installed, so let's open it. FenSens, drive safely. What? Login or create account? So do I have to have an account to use it? That's weird. Why? This is basically something I will never understand. Login. It wants my email and password, or connect with Facebook. Why do I have to connect it with Facebook just to park my car? Let's try to go back. Create account. It wants my name, password, email, and I also have to agree to, I don't even know what, user agreement. There is just a crazy amount of text. Bloody hell! Such a tiny text. Okay, there is a privacy policy. Another crazy amount of text. And finally, warranty policy. Can I click it? Another text. Okay, three heaps of text I have to agree to. So let's put some username in it, a very strong password, and some email. Continue. Create account. Okay, the password has to be at least 6 characters. So don't look. Continue. Create account. I have to turn on my Bluetooth, of course. Now it's on. Welcome, get started. Front or back? Let's say front. Next. Installation. Clearance. Turn it on. Device not found. So let's put the batteries back into it, of course. So the batteries come back in. And let's test it. My cat is helping me, of course. And let's get rid of this box, because a black device on a white surface is just a bad idea. Now that's much better. A device not found. Now the batteries are in, so let's retry it. It found something with some ID. So let's click it. It's vibrating for some reason. And of course, my cat is exploring the box, as cats always do. And does it work? Still doing something? Or do I have to press this button? Not sure. Still doing something? What is doing for so long? After another 5 minutes, it's still rotating here. I'm not sure what's happening. Okay, it's stuck. Nice. So let's try it once more. So I'm logging in once more. What's this? Okay, can I switch it to display the distance of the obstacles? Save tips. Okay, it's covering its ass. I agree. What if I don't agree? It's probably not going to work. Click the button. Does it do anything? Parking. What's happening now? Okay, here you can see some settings. Notification, vibration, sound, Bluetooth, clearance, front, okay. Manage devices, track version, check for updates. And that's it. But does it show anything? It doesn't seem to. That's weird. Or am I doing something wrong? Okay, there is some progress. It got stuck again, but after restarting my phone, it does something, as you can see. It's beeping, and when I get closer to my wall, thank you. It definitely works. Now let's see if the two sensors are independent. So let's approach my table here. And it seems to work. It shows an obstacle only on the left side now. Seems okay. Now right side only. It also works. Now let's see if it can see my sofa, because it's absorbing sound, so it may be harder to detect. But it still works. The sound can be turned off, because it's quite annoying. And it also shows the state of the battery in the sensor, which is useful. And the sensors are kind of clicking or ticking. Can you hear it? Let's put it to the microphone. It's audible from proximity. Now, does each sensor have independent batteries? Let's try it. Let's remove one set of batteries. And what happens? It looks like both sensors are still working. That's odd. And both are also clicking. So it appears to be a backup system. Any pair of batteries can run the entire machine. Let's put the batteries into the other space. And it works again. So it looks like a backup. Now, if I put partially discharged batteries in it, about 1.2 volts, does it work? It does, and it shows the battery about halfway full, half of the battery here. So it definitely seems to work. In the settings, you can pair it with the button. Manage devices, tab buttons. How do I add it? By pressing it? No, by this. If your tab button is not showing up, try pressing it for 5 seconds. Now it shows up. It shows some ID of it. Let's select it. And it should work. Or get stuck, maybe. Okay, it's stuck. Okay, restarting it. Settings again. Manage devices, tab buttons. Add. It's there. And is it stuck again? Okay, now it works, and it even shows the state of the battery in the button. 92%. That's nice. Now, can I start the application by tapping it? Probably not. What's wrong? So I just restarted my phone, and let's try it again. And it seems to work. Let's close it. Once more. It works. I can enable the sound. It works. You can probably also turn it off using the button. Nice. And this button is supposed to be mounted on a steering wheel using this holder to be easily accessible. But occasionally the button stops working. After restarting my phone, it works again. You can log out from the application in settings under Manage Devices. You press log out, it signs out, and now the problem is that if you want to log back in, you can't do so with no internet connection. You can only log in when the internet connection is active. So you can't log in with no internet connection. You have to stay logged in, and I hope the login never expires. Now, what's the power consumption of it? It's about 0.3 milliamps. It's actually pulsing. It's 0.03, but occasionally it's about 0.4. So a good AA lithium battery could be about 3000 mAh and the current is, in average, just a very rough guess, about 0.1 mA. So the batteries could last about 30,000 hours in standby, which is about 3.5 years. And the active current is about 25 mA with those older batteries, or about 15 mA with those new batteries. So the current goes down when the voltage goes up. It seems to contain a switching inverter. But now, of course, let's take a look in it. Let's begin with the button because it's going to be much more simple. It's basically just a tiny button with a battery cover, the battery, and how do I open it up? There are no screws in it. It probably just clicks together. There is a gap. It's definitely not designed to be opened. As you can see, it's either clicking in or it's glued. Not sure. And that's it. So here's the board which comes out and here you can see the microcontroller, some crystal oscillator probably, some capacitors, resistors, more capacitors and resistors, the button, some programming interface, the antenna of it, and from the other side there's just the battery holder and nothing else. The antenna is quite tiny, but the manual says about 10 meters range. Here you can see the marking of the components. Let's try to connect my oscilloscope to the antenna. I can see some pulsing. Not the actual signal because the frequency is way too high, but its envelope. It's transmitting some data in pulses. Now let's take a look into the actual sensors. And there is a lot of screws in it. About 16 of them, and that's it. Or actually 17. One is longer and it doesn't have a symmetrical counterpart. Can I open it now? Yes, it opens like this. And here you can see the electronics in it. Two tiny boards here and here. The sensors and some cables and connections. And here is the antenna on another board. It looks like this. So let's take a closer look at it. Here is the ultrasonic transducer, the first board, some cables, battery holders, And here is the other board, the other transducer and the antenna. Now let's take a look at the components. So here's my CAT, and here's the smaller board with an 8-pin chip, some tiny resistors and capacitors, some diodes here, about 3 transistors, a tantalum capacitor, another diode probably, few more resistors and capacitors, and here's the connection to the transducer. And on the other board, there are probably the same components as on the first one. 3 transistors, an 8-pin chip, a tantalum capacitor, some resistors and capacitors here, tiny ones, and the connection to the transducer. But there is also some extra circuitry with a 6-pin chip, some microcontroller, some crystals probably, tiny capacitors, another 3 6-pin chips, another tiny capacitors and resistors, and some inductors, probably in a switching inverter, a switching voltage regulator, maybe a buck regulator or a boost regulator. Here you can see the microcontroller and the 8-pin chip, which is the same as the other one. Those are just double op-amps. And on the other side of the board, there is some coil or transformer, maybe a matching transformer for the transducer to match its impedance. And there is a capacitor and the connector, and that's it. And the other board, the bigger one, also has a transformer, a capacitor and a connector. And that's it. And the connector has a marking, echo, 40 kHz, 5 volts and ground. And the other one is the same. And those 2 pairs of batteries seem to be just in parallel. So mixing new batteries with old batteries is not a good idea, because the new ones would charge the old ones. Now connecting my oscilloscope to one of the transducers, and it looks about like this. It's transmitting bursts of a carrier frequency, which is about 40 kHz, because now it's 5 microseconds per division and the period is about 5 divisions, or 25 microseconds, which is 40 kHz. And the pulses or bursts repeat at a 10 Hz rate. Now, because the oscilloscope is scanning very slow, let's take a look at a long shutter picture. And if I measure both channels, it reveals that they are alternating to prevent interferencing each other. And of course, the pulses are very short, and this is why the peaks on the oscilloscope are very dim. And the voltage of the pulses is quite high. The oscilloscope is set to 2 volts per division, but the probe is times 10, so it's 20 volts per division vertically. Now it's about 6 divisions, which means about 120 volts peak to peak. And the reflected signal is not visible here, because it's very weak in comparison to the amplitude of the transmission. And as you can see, the waveform is changing when I cover the sensor. And here's the boost regulator inductor. Here the switching transistor inside of some chip is on, and here the diode is on. The peak voltage is almost 6 volts, but without the drop of the diode, it's close to 5 volts. It's 0.5 microseconds per division, and the period is 1, 2, 3, 4 divisions, which means about 2 microseconds, which means 500 kHz. Here seems to be the reflected signal from the op-amp. It changes as I move it around. That's interesting. When I cover it, there is no signal. Each peak is a signal reflected from some object. The farther it is, the longer it takes for the signal to come back. The first strong peak is probably detected and measured, probably something like this one. Now it's visible, getting closer, farther, closer, farther, getting closer, farther, getting closer, farther. And the voltage from the regulator is 5.3 volts. That's very expected. And the transducers are... It looks like this, and it's basically just a high frequency speaker which also works as a microphone. So that's about it. It works well, it's a nice design and I like it. The only problem is that it can take some time before you set the application up and make it working. You have to have a smartphone, an internet connection and some knowledge how to use it. You have to get the application and make an account, so it may not be the right gift for your grandfather, for example. Some people would probably prefer a dedicated indicator with maybe just a bar graph made of LEDs or just a single purpose display, which comes with the device and can be permanently installed in the car. But on the other hand, some people prefer to have everything paired with their phone and control everything with just one device. And if somebody steals it, he can't use it because it's paired with your phone and he can't use it with another phone without knowing your password. The application sometimes gets stuck, but it can be fixed by an update. It's a bit overcomplicated in comparison with a dedicated display, but on the other hand, you get a lot of extra features you can't have with a dedicated display. So this is Diagon Wild, and see you in my next videos, and thanks to all of my patrons on Patreon. I really appreciate your support.